for you. Some people won't record me, so don't say it didn't matter. Okay. Now, question one is actually very simple. This is, I just pulled out the assignment, the sample by one of your classmates. This is the sample, 100 records. Okay. And the first of this one is. Okay. First one says, what is the proportion in percentage form? What is the proportion of female users and iPhone users? So that's pretty straightforward. You have to just say, how many female users are there in your sample? There's one easy way I told you to do that, is to apply the filter and remove all the male records. You'll end up with only the female records. It's better to copy the whole stuff in a separate sheet. So you can copy and paste here. Now this sheet has got only the female records, right? And how many does this person have? You remove the first one. 50 means one less, 49. So this person, and they're saying show it in a percentage form, so it's 49%. Okay. Same you do with iPhone. So you'll just apply a filter. This time you apply a different filter. So I want the male records back, but I want to remove Samsung and other phone users, and I'm left with Apple. I'll just choose everything, copy, and yes. And these are my Apple, so all of these are only Apple users, right? And how many does this person have? 73 and one less. Yeah, you're getting hard in many cases. So 73 and one less. 72%. Now they ask a little bit compensable. That's the important part, right? Now keep in mind that this is a proportion question. In general, now you don't need any Excel to do this. It's just handwritten, but prior to waiting, you need to clean. So normally, confidence interval. It's like this, right? You have your mean minus something, which is usually this, standard deviation divided by square root of n, and mean plus z times standard deviation divided by square root of n. Right? Usually that's how it is. But this is a proportion question, so you can't tell. In proportions, your formula just changes a little bit. Z times standard deviation and proportion plus Z times standard deviation. But I have written Z, but I'm just assuming it's Z. You have to clarify why you're choosing Z, not T. Right? So when you're dealing with proportions, this is how the formula is like, and there's a principle. There's a principle about Z that if, does anyone know? That's for numbers, normal numbers. In proportions, your n times p is greater than pi, then you use the z value. In this case, your n, how many do we have? So if you're doing, the question is about iPhone users. And how many iPhone users? 72. So 72 is and is about 100, so that's definitely greater than pi, right? So that's why you use the z in this case, right? So one thing is given that we use the z, and the z value we get from the table, right? So we'll get this from the table. Proportion we know, it's 72%. That's what we're guessing, right? This person has got 72% iPhone users. And what about this? Again, standard deviation, when you're dealing with proportions, we have a formula for this. 72%, right? One ISP, and N is 100 out of 100 records, 72% are iPhone users, so that's your standard deviation. So now we have everything. Because we know P and N, we know standard deviation, we know the proportion, 72% people are iPhone users, and Z value will get from the table. So everything's there, and we'll complete very confident. One more thing you have to do, because they ask you to show it graphically as well. So I can do this by hand, but don't draw it by hand in your assignment. Okay? There's a picture that can show it like this. So if you're making an interval over 72%, right? So your confidence interval will be, let's say 68 here, and let's say 76 here. So show something like this. And your interval in the end is going to look like this. 68. These are random numbers, I'm not giving you exact. Anyhow, it's going to look like this. There's something slightly less than 72, and some slightly higher than 72, right? That's where the likelihood is there, to find your proportion. Where do you get this chart? Do you remember in week 9? Let's go to week 9. In week 9, we used an Excel file. Here, confidence interval. Just open up this Excel file and you will see this chart here. You can just copy and paste it, but at least change the numbers. It should be 72% here. This would be your lower interval, will be the higher one. Let's say 68 and 76 or something like that, right? Just copy this from here and paste it from here after you show your workings. Okay? This will be. And that's how you do confidence interval. Same thing goes here, only that in question 3 and 4, you do not have proportion. This is not a proportion question. Because here we're dealing with the average monthly salary, average monthly earnings of the students, in dollar terms, not in percentage terms. So how do you get the average? I'll just do it for, let's say, you got females. Okay, so average, and this is the earning column. So average, I can get it by the formula, equal to average. All of you have done this in the first assignment, first project. Drag down, look back in, and this is your average. Okay? Around 1200, and the same is for males. You can do it by yourself, this part. Then they tell you to build a 95% confidence interval for each gender, so it means you need to build two confidence intervals. In this case, again, now we don't need any Excel, but shoulder working, you don't need Excel. This time you're going to use this formula, the normal one. Z times standard deviation divided by square root of n, x bar plus z times standard deviation divided by square root of n. Right? Z, we know we will get it from the table. Right? The average salary, we know, is going to. We just calculated that. That was around $1,100 something. So this thing we know. This thing we know. N, we know, N is the number of records that we have. Right? This is the only thing that we do not know. And this time we can't use that proportion formula because this is not a proportion question. So how do we find the standard deviation of earnings of the students? That's the question. Any thoughts? You can't apply that formula to standard deviation, right? It's too complicated and it's too time consuming. There's an easy way out. I want, let's say for females, I want standard deviation of all of these numbers. Excel can do it for you. So there's a, make it bigger. So there's a function, STDEV, standard deviation. You get two options at the top, STDEV.P for population and .S for sample. Which one should we use? Sound, not S, because we're dealing with the sound. Right? And then Excel is asking where are the numbers. I tell Excel, keep there. These are my numbers. Just give me the standard deviation of all of these numbers. And there you go. You got standard deviation 7.5, and it's plugged into the formula. Now you have everything. Now you also have the standard deviations. And everything else is done. Right? That's how we build the standard deviation. Confidence interval. Also for these two, both of these two confidence interval, you're going to copy and paste that picture, but make sure the visual is correct. You didn't miss anything. Let's move. So these were up to four. Now there's only one question left, right? This is usually students find it extremely difficult for some reason. I don't know why, it's just too challenging a question maybe. But it's just the same set of four steps, right? Always those same four steps. And the last one is the conclusion. So, the question says that there was a survey in the US, and they found out by that survey that more than 50 iPhone users, there's more than 50% of the people in the US use iPhone. Okay? Now we're going to compare the results of this survey with your sample, because you also have a sample, right? Your sample says, how many do we have? Apple iPhone users, these are Apple users. So we're about 72 out of 100 iPhone users, 72%. Okay? So we're testing, we're going to do a hypothesis that is our sample significantly different from this survey results. How do you build the hypothesis? The same four steps, like I said. Step one, you build the hypothesis, H0 and alternate HA. Right? One tip that I gave you early on, always equal to sign must come here. Right? So if you're dealing with a proportion, they're saying more than 50% of the US market, which means we are testing whether our sample is significantly greater than 50% or not. So 50% is the norm, and we are testing whether this norm holds, right? So the proportion was found to be 50%, equal to sign must come here, and what will come here? You know that you're still, it's either 50% or it's not 50%, but are we using the non-equal tool? That depends on the question. Yeah, well, it's because they're saying more than 50%, right? So if 50% is not true, then alternate is more than 50% because they give in the question. They also underline it so that you don't miss that. So we have a greater than sign here. Okay? Now our hypothesis is done. Now, like I said, it's up to you. Do you want to choose a p-value or the q-value? P-value is easier if it's given to you, but they haven't given you the p-values or anything like the p-value either. So the easier one is yellow, not p. Now, if it's not p-value method, then what method should we choose? Should it be the z-table or should it be the t-table? Again, this is a proportion question, so you can easily say that if your n times p is greater than 5, then you use z. Z step or Z table, right? Which in this case is, because it's 50% and your N is the number of users that you have, 100. So definitely it's greater than 50, it's certainly greater than 5. You're going to use Z value. So like I said, my Z, or you can say calculated Z, or my Z is, oh sorry, just P. P minus P. P cap minus P divided by the standard deviation, that's the formula. P hat, you know, is 72% in this case. This person has 72% app users. We are testing for 50, so this 50 comes here. Can standard deviation be or no? How do we find it? Again, same proportion method. P times 1 minus P divided by N. We take the square root. That'll be your standard deviation. Now we know p hat, we know p, we know the standard deviation by this formula. And whatever Z value that you get, let's say it's 5.8. Now, many students actually have been asking me, I've been getting some emails that I got a Z stat of 6.4 or 5.5 or something like this. They're saying, is it too high? It just doesn't look realistic. Actually, there's nothing wrong with it. 5.8 is actually a very reasonable number. Even 6 or even 7. Actually, in one of the examples that we did, we had 13, I think, or 14 or something like that. So this number is fine. If it's not to extract X value, then we do the table. We go to the table, find the Z value. I suppose it's going to be, I think it's 1.65 if it's 95% on one side. There's a one channel test. And then if it's higher, if your Z, so basically we are testing, we have only one tail, right? Greater than. So only the greater than side gives us a rejection. You're testing for 50%, and if we fall too far down, we're going to reject. Let's say we got 5.8. This was the cutoff point. This is 1.65. And we landed here, 5.8, too far down. Then what do we do?
Reject
the null. Reject what? Reject the null type. So this thing gets rejected, which means this thing gets accepted, so the portion is significantly higher than 50%. That'll be a conclusion. Unless you have a small proportion in your sample. Alright? So in the end, you'll just say, step 4, you'll say reject. Most probably you'll say reject. And step 5, you'll say, we can conclude that the number of iPhone users in our sample is significantly higher than the survey number of iPhone users in the US market. And that should do it. If you have further questions, you can definitely ask. Also, one last announcement. Before the final exam, there are some consultations which will be posted on LMS. My consultation is on November 1 on Friday. And there are other